It's time for Timothy Church Mouse. Yes, it's time for Timothy and all his friends to greet you. So let's follow Timothy into the old church tower for today's adventure in the Castle of Keys.
What? Oh, well, I'm sorry, Timothy. I guess I was so involved in reading this book that I didn't even notice you.
What are you doing, Reverend Good? Studying for your sermon?
No, Timothy, I'm just reading for fun.
Reading for fun? Are you kidding?
Oh, I guess I'm a little like your friend Jeremiah. I'm a real bookworm at heart. Once I pick up a good book, I just can't put it down.
Boy, I can think of a lot more fun things to do than read an old book.
That's where you're mistaken, Timothy. You see, once you open the pages of a book, you unlock worlds of adventure. You meet exciting new people. Why, between the covers of a book, you have the key to the knowledge of the world.
Gosh, I didn't come to hear a sermon. I just wanted to ask you if I could go fishing.
Sorry. I guess I did get carried away. Run along and have fun. Say, Timothy, before you go, why don't you take along a book to read? Here, let me find you a good one.
No thanks, Reverend Good. I'll be too busy fishing. See you later.
All right, Timothy. Hope you catch a whale.
This is the life. Peaceful, quiet, and lots of fish, I hope. Sure is pretty out here on the riverbank. Everything looks so green and smells so good. Lots of snowy white clouds today, kind of drifting by, lazy-like. Boy, that cloud over there looks like a big old fat man with wrinkles. That one over there looks like a super duper ice cream cone with two dips. Yummy. And that big one over there looks just like a big beautiful castle. Wonder if a giant lives there. Or maybe a beautiful princess.
Thank you. Hello, Timothy. When I saw you approaching, I sent my phantom regiment to escort you. Welcome to my castle.
Who are you?
I'm Lady Locket, mistress of the Castle of Keys.
Castle of Keys? What kind of castle is that?
It's the most exciting castle in the clouds. There are 1,000 rooms in my castle, and each room holds a new adventure.
Golly! I've never been in a castle full of adventures. I've never even been in an ordinary old castle. 1,000 rooms?
Lady Locket, Lady Locket, I've been looking all over for you. I've been feeding the peacocks and swans down on the Royal Lagoon, and I want you to...
Whimsy, where are your manners? We have a guest.
A guest? A guest? Oh, goody, goody, a guest.
Whimsy, this is my little friend, Timothy Churchmouse. Timothy, Whimsy has been the court jester at the Castle of Keys for, well, longer than I can remember. He's ever so much fun.
Hi, Whimsy.
Hi, Timothy. You good at riddles?
Well, sometimes.
Riddly, 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 ree. See if you can answer this riddle for me. If you feed a cow money, what do you get?
Oh, gosh. I don't know.
Rich milk, get it? Now, what word begins with the last letter of the alphabet and ends with the first letter?
I give up, Whimsy. Tell me.
Zebra. Starts with Z and ends with A.
All right, Whimsy. That's enough of your foolishness for now. Would you please bring me the magic key ring?
No sooner said than done.
Wow! I've never seen so many keys. Do they open the doors of the 1,000 rooms in your castle?
Yes, they do, Timothy. These are the keys to knowledge and adventure. Since you are our guest, you may have your choice. Select a key, and we will see which door it opens.
Oh, golly, they're all so different. Some look like they've never been used. Here's one that looks like a musical note. I think I'll take that one.
Good. That's the key to the music room, Timothy. Come, let's hurry along. Through here.
Doors look like book covers. Look, this one says History Hall. Here's one that says Science Lab. Oh boy, Fairy Tale Tunnel. Art Gallery. Space Dome. Hero Hall. Boy, I'd like to go in every one of these rooms. Here it is. Here's the music room.
Very fine. Now, when I slip the music key into the keyhole, you be very still, and I promise you, you will enjoy the experience.
Beautiful, yes? This music that surrounds us, that, my dear friend, is called the creation. This music is called an oratorio. Oh, I am very proud of it. Perhaps I should be more modest, but no, I wrote it, and I am indeed proud of it. Oh, but forgive me. You're probably wondering who this funny old man is. My name is Joseph Haydn. I was born in another time in history, in the year 1736, in the beautiful countryside of southern Austria. Oh, such a funny little boy I was. Such a big imagination for a little tyke. One day, when I was only 4 years old, an old farmer was milking his cow, which was tied to a post outside the barn. Suddenly, from inside the barn, came the sound, moo, moo. Well, since he only had one cow, he nearly fell off the seat. Moo, moo! There was another cow in the barn. He could hear her moving about in the straw. Oh, well, this was too much. It must be a witch. People believed in witches in Austria back in 1740. Well, with his knees knocking together in fright, the farmer entered the barn. And there I was, crawling around in the straw, pretending to be a cow. Oh, I was always pretending to be a bird or an animal. Sometimes Papa would tell the dog to stop barking, and it would be I. One day he thought that the cat had brought her kittens in behind the kitchen stove. It was I. Papa made wheels for carriages and for stagecoaches. Oh, how I loved to play with the sawdust. I fastened the shavings onto my hair for curls. They said I had the ear of a musical genius. I made the sounds of the saw and the plane, as well as the sounds of the animals in the house and barn. There were no toys, but I never missed them. I was a very happy boy. In fact, it was my voice that caused my happy childhood to end suddenly when I was only 6 years old. Cousin Johann Frank, a schoolteacher, visited. He heard me sing. Now, he knew that my father could not afford to send me to school, so he said, "I would like to take Joseph home with me to Heinberg. He ought to learn to read and write, and he can help my wife for his board, and I shall teach him some music, too." So the next day, in an ox cart which my father had built, we went to Heinberg. Oh, and I sang all the way. Little did I realize that I would never live at home again. Life at Cousin Frank's was grim. I was babysitter. I washed the dishes and helped with the housework the minute I got home from school. Oh, I worried because my clothes weren't clean. I washed my hands and combed my hair and tried to hold books over spots in my shirt, but at least I was learning to read and write German. Then again, my voice caused my life to change. Johann Reuter from the Vienna Choir Boys School visited Cousin Franz when I was 8 years old. He said, "This boy could get a free education in Vienna with his beautiful true tones." Cousin Frank agreed. Oh, I was glad to leave all those stacks of dishes. At the choir school, I learned to play the piano and the violin, to sing part music, and to read and write Italian. I had 9 years at the choir school when my voice again caused a change. This time, my boy soprano was becoming a man's voice. And since the Empress did not like my croak, I was dismissed. After some years of teaching music, with never enough money to live on, I was hired by Prince Paul Anton Esterhazy to live at one of the palaces. There I directed the music for orchestra, choir, operas, and Sunday church service. For over 40 years, I stayed at this one place, writing music every day. Each morning, I dressed in my best clothes and knelt down to pray. I thought, God gives me my musical ideas, so I must be neatly dressed to meet him. The ideas come, I wrote them down on paper. When I was 55 years old, I went to England and heard Handel's glorious Messiah. That is when I decided to write an oratorio about the creation as it is described in the Old Testament of the Bible. In the oratorio, as the creation took place, I introduced the sounds of birds singing and animals lowing. With my reverence for God and his love for all living creatures, I could not do it any other way.
What beautiful music! And what a wonderful story! Lady Lockett, was that true? Was there really a Joseph Haydn?
Yes, Timothy. Sometimes, I'm sure, you hear his great music played on the big organ in your church. But time is passing, my little friend, and you should be going home.
Oh, please, Lady Lockett, please let me choose one key before Timothy leaves.
Please, Lady Lockett?
Oh, very well. Just one more room. Which one will it be, Whimsy?
I never can decide. I'll take this one, I think.
Oh, one of my very favorite rooms. Whimsy selected the one that looks like a long paintbrush, Timothy. The key to the art gallery.
The art gallery. Hip, hip, hooray!
Is that a good one?
This room is always filled with beauty. And each time we open it, a different artist's paintings are on display. Here we go. Look. It's the Mona Lisa.
Mm-hmm. my smile. You're wondering, as have many people before you, the Mona Lisa. Such a mysterious smile. And why am I smiling? Well, there are those who say that the musicians who played as I posed charmed this smile to my lips. But perhaps the real secret of my smile was inspired by the delightful young man, so handsome, so beautifully dressed, who painted my portrait. No ordinary man was this Leonardo from Vinci, near Florence. You have heard of him, no doubt, Leonardo da Vinci. And how I wish you could have known him, so gentle and kind-hearted. But that was long ago, at the same time in history, that another adventurous man from Italy, Christopher Columbus, was off to discover a new land, your America. My husband, Francesco del Giocondo, told me one sunny day that he had commissioned this renowned Leonardo to put my likeness on canvas. I was really quite flattered and eager with anticipation to meet him. Oh, I had heard so much about him. It was impossible that one man could be capable of so many great skills and possess such talents. This I had to see to believe. For instance, who ever heard of a man flying through the air like a bird? But this was the great dream of the amazing Leonardo. He would say to my husband and me, "In my mind, I see it so clearly, like a great bird with outstretched wings dipping through the clear air, now low, now high." One day, he would say, "There will surely be a bird-like ship which shall fly through the air. This is bound to be. It is only a question of how to make the form of the ship and the wings, and most of all, the spark that will make them go." He dreamed dreams and drew plans, and it took men almost 5 centuries to catch up with his advanced ideas and make them reality with what you now call airplanes. This star maker man had so many talents. Even as a golden-haired child, he was outstanding. He read books, not many, it is true, but the printing press had just been invented. And he was fond of music and can sing and play the lute. He wrote poems and composed music to sing with them. And such an athlete. Oh, a splendid horseman was he, so strong that when he grew older, he could bend a horseshoe easily with his hands. And all the time, even when he was painting, his mathematical and creative genius would lead him astray, and he would busy himself inventing things, diving suits, a new compass, the camera, the paddle boat, the flying machine, all unheard of in the minds of the 15th century men, except in the mind of this man to whom God had given so much creativity. Even to receive a letter from Leonardo was original. Who else would write from right to left with his left hand, so that only by holding the letter up to a mirror could he read it? And this was the man my husband selected to capture my image on canvas. Little did I dream how true were his words when he said, "Behold, Madonna, thy portrait shall one day please the world." 4 years have I worked, and at last I have caught the spirit, the soul that looks through thine eyes. And yet, when he came to releasing the portrait to my husband, he declared he wanted to work further to perfect it. And never did we possess this work of art. Today it hangs at the Louvre in France, one of the world's greatest art museums. Some say it was his greatest masterpiece, but others, and I am inclined to be among them, feel that his magnificent painting of the Last Supper was truly his greatest. When the Duke Lodovico's beautiful bride, Beatrice d'Este, died, the Duke ordered Leonardo to decorate Beatrice's favorite church. So, in 1496, he started work illustrating the moment when Jesus said to his disciples, "One of you shall betray me." It is said that each time Leonardo took up his brush to work on the figure of Christ, his hand trembled. At last, he left the central figure unfinished because he despaired of making it perfect. Alas, during the centuries that followed, because of faulty paints and floods, the original painting faded. And fortunately, many of his students made perfect reproductions. They are on display in churches throughout the world, and you have seen a copy of it in your own church, perhaps. Oh, yes, God gave this man, Leonardo da Vinci, great creative genius and remarkable talents. And Leonardo used them for us to enjoy and appreciate. Art is a common language that can be understood by people of all lands. An artist in Italy once said, "If you get simple beauty and naught else, you get about the best thing God invented." Enjoy it, my little friends, and appreciate it.
Golly, I almost feel like I know her in person. And that Mr. Leonardo who painted her picture. And you know, that other picture she was telling us about, the Last Supper one? We do have a big picture of that hanging in our church. I'm really gonna look at it good when I get back.
Speaking of getting back, Timothy, I'm afraid you really must go.
Leave now? Before we open any more doors? Oh no, Lady Lockett. I want to stay. I want to go through the other doors.
You can, Timothy. You can.
But how? I live way down there. I may never get to come back to the Castle of Keys, and then I'll never know what's inside all those rooms.
Timothy, you don't have to return to this cloud castle to discover those rooms. Each door, if you noticed, was the cover of a book. And God gave you the keys to open them. You have two wonderful eyes and a fine mind. Use them. Each book is a world in itself. You'll be a wealthy man, because knowledge is one of the greatest riches of all.
Lady Lockett, may I give Timothy my magic bookmark, please? So he'll remember us always.
I think that would be a fine gesture, Whimsy.
Here, Timothy. See, it's shaped like a key. Then you'll never lose your place in a book, and you won't turn down the pages and ruin the book either.
Thank you, Whimsy. And you too, Lady Lockett, for everything. You're both the greatest.
And now, Timothy, time to leave. Farewell. Farewell.
Lady Lockett, they're gone. They're gone. The Cloud Castle, the Castle of Keys. It's gone. But my bookmark, it's here. Wait till I tell Reverend Good and Kathleen. Oh no, they'll never believe me. This'll be just my own private secret. I think I'll go back, though, and see how Reverend Good is getting along with his reading. Maybe I'll ask him to find a book for me to read. Those fish aren't biting anyway. Hi, Reverend Good. I've got a riddle for you.
You do. Well, Timothy, I'm pretty good at riddles. Fire away.
What word starts with the last letter of the alphabet and ends with the first?
I'm afraid I'll have to give up.
A zebra, of course! By the way, Reverend Good, you mentioned some old books I might like to read. May I borrow them?
Fine, Timothy, fine. Let's go into the library and find out a very exciting one. And the boy grew in wisdom and in strength and in favor with God and man.
What'd you say, Reverend Good?
Oh, nothing, Timothy. It's just something I read in a book. Just something I read in a book.
It's time now to leave the old church tower, but join us again next week for another exciting adventure with Timothy and his friends. The voice of Timothy Church Mouse was Beth Harris. Pat Moore was heard as Lady Locket and Clint Major as Whimsy. Bess Wright was heard as the Mona Lisa. Dale Higstrom appeared as Reverend Good, and Ken Hickson was seen as Joseph Hayden. Puppeteering today were Susan Lambertus, Beryl Crismore, Bea Mackerett, Molly Donaldson, and Wilma Aniker. Musical animations were directed by Martha Ellis, assisted by Pat McClure, Bonnie Gray, Ellie Bachman, and Bill Ellis. Artwork was created by Pat Reagan, Bonnie Gray, Joellen Miller, Beryl Crismore, Dee DeGraw, Ellie Bachman, Bea Mackerett, and Patty Arnold. Special puppets and costumes designed by Anita Cox, Pat Reagan, Helen Wise, Bea Mackerett, and Sally Williams.